to Ordinary Saints. My name is Kira, and this is my new friend Ellen, our summer seminarian at our church. And we're here today to talk to you about ordinary saints along the way that have helped us in our faith. So, Ellen, maybe we can talk a little bit about ordinary saints and just why we came up with that topic.
Yeah, it seemed that we wanted to capture people that were important to us in our lives, and we tossed around words like ordinary or unlikely, and just who those people were that helped shape us and form us in our calling and on our vocation to where we're at today. So,
yeah, and I think it's really encouraging for us when we're looking at people like that and we know them in both their flaws and also in their gifts, and that's kind of a helpful thing for us as we're working through our own faith and our own kind of discernment process.
Yeah, that's so true. It really helps, you know, sort of understand the complexity of the humans that we are, but also the grace that we're given in that that can be still honorable and something to see, you know, kind of past and through, but, you know, see the person as a whole.
Yeah.
And how God, you know, still uses them in your life.
And we've been kind of thinking about that with scripture. We have all these characters where we get that close look.
Yeah.
But why don't we talk a little bit about the people that you actually know, not just in the pages of the Bible, but some of those people for you in your life as you kind of think through your testimony?
Yeah. So the people that I chose for my uncommon or unlikely was kind of the word that jived with me in terms of who I was going to pick for my saints were my parents. And I think the reason why I sort of thought more about them as unlikely was because they're first and foremost my parents.
Right.
And so, like, parents as saints, not that that's an oxymoron, it definitely is not. But it just seems like a funny, you know, pairing in a way, because these are people that help, you know, navigate you through life in a way that sometimes that's really helpful, and other times, you know, especially during adolescence, you're a bit more rebellious and you're thinking, like, you know, there's no way that they know who I am and what's best for me, until you get a bit older and you realize, oh, I see. I see what you're doing there. It also becomes different in terms of my own vocational journey, because my dad is a minister and my mom is a social worker. So I've got those dynamics that have been at play, this pastoral sense in both of them, that, you know, upon realizing that I'm being called into ministry and accepting that call, just how instrumental that relationship and that example has been to me, even though I didn't really know it. Like I said, this sort of like looking back and being like, oh, I see now how that has formed me, is kind of, like I said, what makes them unlikely to me. So
do you think if when you were 10, like, think of 10-year-old Ellen.
Yeah.
And yeah, you could visit 10-year-old Ellen and say, guess what I'm doing right now?
Oh, my gosh.
I'm in seminary. Yeah. I'm training to be a priest.
Yeah.
What would 10-year-old Ellen say?
Well, 10-year-old Ellen would have been grade 5. And probably, like, at that point in my life, that probably would have been such a weird thing. I probably would have said there's no way that that's at all what I would have been doing. I wasn't feeling that call, but I still knew that my faith had a large drive in my personality and in the things that I did and I liked and how I moved through the world. But there's just, it, you know, I was too busy playing like N64 and, you know, I was still running outside and playing with my neighbors, and the bigger cares of the world were not something that I was too concerned.
Yes.
I mean, I feel like if you had told me maybe at like 15, I would have been so much more sort of rebellious about that.
Yes. So that's the time where you're kind of pushing against the expectations around what it looks like to be a minister's daughter.
Absolutely.
And kind of being in that context, all those pressures, and you're trying to figure out who you are as yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're trying to sort of navigate what makes you different from your parents. And I think that I was sort of saying, and in that, I mean, it's not just that, there's that spiritual aspect that is really difficult to sort of navigate when you're working through all of those societal pressures and peer pressures and just all of those things that other people don't understand when they're not the daughter of a minister. And like a lot of kids that I went to school with didn't go to church, so I didn't really have anybody I could sort of bounce any like ideas off of or problems off of. It was a very solitary feeling, aside from my sister, who is also, first of all, one of my best friends, is my best friend, and is the only other person who knows what it's like in this situation to be brought up by, you know, my parents. And she, even for that, is a saint in my eyes. So, yeah, it's difficult when you've got something that you can't explain to other people. When really what you're seeking is that community. But when your community is based off of something just totally different from what everybody else is experiencing, it does make it hard.
Yeah. It feels really isolating.
Yeah. 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 It does. And even like thinking about the prayer book and the liturgy of the mm-hmm. Anglican Church, I mean, I knew those words since I was a child. I remember like laying in the pew and watching my mom say the Lord's Prayer and being like, I'm laying here and she's just like totally paying attention to this liturgy that I don't understand yet. But those memories, those core memories are so important to me now because I say those words and I think about my mom saying them too. I mean, there's that sort of like generational aspect where you think, something that they, like, it's like a seed that they planted and is now flourishing, and I get to, like, reap the benefit of something that they did for me so long ago. And it's hard not to be grateful for that, and I don't know, it's made me who I am today.
Yeah. I think it's also about, like, coming back to the topic of ordinary saints. Mm. The communion of saints means that, like, my life and my spiritual life is bigger than just me.
Yeah.
And so when we're thinking about ordinary saints and our testimonies, we're looking to see how my sense of self is actually far more porous than sometimes I want
yeah.
to believe or allow to yeah. be true. But that is a gift that mm-hmm. all of these people have impacted me along the way.
Yeah.
And they have left their marks on me and are continuing to do that. And their virtues are kind of imprinted on me in a way, in some way. And their vices are things that I have learned from and I'm learning from as
yeah.
well. And with my own virtues and vices
yeah.
kind of being in play. And that's kind of the gift of what it means to be the body together mm-hmm. is that we're not doing it by ourselves.
Yeah.
So that doesn't mean all of the places that I am weak are just going to be failures in my life
yeah.
because I'm being propped up
yeah.
by this body together.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so true. And like, you know, you inherit so many interesting aspects of your parents, and part of what we do is kind of carrying on the torch, you know. It's like in Flanders Field where they say, you know, the torch be yours to hold it high, and if ye break faith to us. Anyways, it's just it's like passing on, right?
That's a Canadian reference.
Yes, that is. And so I think about that too, like what are the things that like, what is my mom sort of, what's the, and my dad, like what are the burdens that they've carried for me? And then where do I sort of like pick up and carry that on yeah. for the next generation? And it's, I think that's just like the gift that we give to one another.
I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about your first sermon here
yeah.
and what that felt like and that response that you had from that one parishioner. I remember you
oh,
telling
yeah.
me. So I think that kind of ties.
Yeah, together. Yeah, for sure. So I had a lot of anxiety around, you know, writing my first sermon. And I think it's because when I imagined doing ministry and like one of the like roadblocks for me, I think maybe even just like in accepting the call was thinking, I can't preach. Like, I can't write a sermon and do that week after week. I remember, I don't know, probably when I was in high school, sitting in the pew and watching the minister preach and think, I can't believe he has to do that week after week. And like, there's no way I could ever do that, you know? And I think there were a bunch of reasons as to why I felt that way. But, you know, I spent a lot of time doing that and I prayed a lot and I cried a lot. And eventually I got up and I gave my first sermon and I felt, you know, as soon as I was up there, I felt good. And I felt like the spirit was with me. It was really like...
It was so obvious.
Yeah, yeah, thanks. It all of a sudden I thought, oh, yes, this is, you know, what I'm meant to be doing. God really was affirming that in many ways. Anyhow, so I was, you know, shaking hands with people at the end of the service, and this man walked by and he goes, well, wouldn't you know, the gospel is being preached by the next generation. And I just, like, I don't even think I could respond because I was so, like, emotional about that. I was like, you don't even know what that means to me. And I mean, the other thing is, like, my mom's dad was a minister. So my mom's the daughter of a minister. Sides. Yeah, so, you know, dad being a minister, like, there's just all of this sort of, you know, family ties that it's just really impactful, because it also feels like all of that time spent and being part of the family and hearing all of those sermons, like, it's always like it's marinating and like it's serving a purpose beyond just listening to it. And and so for that comment to really hold that weight that it did, it really meant so much to me.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Could you read for us Psalm 145? I know that's kind of the scriptural foundation of what we've been talking
about. Yeah, you bet. So this, as I was saying to you sort of before we were doing all of this, like anything at this point that is like from generation to generation, I'm like, oh, you know, like a puddle, because it just really feels so, obviously so at home, or, you know, it's ringing true.
Right.
So Psalm 145 starts with, I will exalt you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works.
I like the idea of one generation to the next passing on this message. And that's how we have the scriptures at all, right?
Yeah.
Is that God's people preserved these texts for us so that generation to generation could tell God's story to the next.
It's almost wild to be like living that sort of real time.
Yeah.
You know, it's almost like, you know, it's like you're in the biblical story.
Well, we are.
Exactly.
You know? And that's something that when I try to teach about this, I try to help people think our world doesn't contain scripture. Scripture contains our world.
Yeah,
and so we're living in the pages of the Bible between Genesis and Revelation, which is it's a kind of a flip of how we normally think. But this isn't just any book.
Yeah. No, it's the book of life right here. No. So it's, I was saying to you too, like in the prayer after communion, we say, you know, I forget exactly how it goes, but the power of God working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine.
Glory to God from generation to generation.
Yeah.
In the church and in Christ Jesus.
Yeah. And it's just like, like I said, you know, the prayer book now just holds this like different weight, having said it my whole life. And that's the beauty of it. I mean, I know people are afraid of the liturgy sometimes, and maybe it's sort of, I don't know, run its course, or maybe it sounds too old, but I think the beauty of it is that it is scripture, and so it's going to hit you at different times and different times of your life, so.
Well, and it's, you know, these are prayers that have been prayed across generation to generation.
Yeah.
And so when we say that prayer after communion, it's, you know, from generation to generation. So this layer of our human families, this layer of the church across time and place, which creates brothers and sisters in Christ, and then in Christ Jesus, who is that final kind of body that we are brought up into.
Yeah, yeah.
So as you go into the rest of your week, kind of want you to be thinking about how is the gospel being proclaimed by the next generation? How do you see that kind of with the people that are coming after you? How have you received it and what has come before you? And who are maybe those ordinary saints for you? So thanks for joining us, and thank you, Ellen.
Thank you.